How's everybody?
We're good.
I'm sorry?
We're good.
Good. In my right hand, Rincon Valley Cowboy Church coffee mug. We got 6 left over there. Don't leave without purchasing one. The low price of $5. Okay. Couple announcements I want to get out of the way. Over on the welcome table, baby bottles are to be turned in next week. That's correct?
Yes.
Okay. Monday, Labor Day, 6 p.m., the Bible study's been canceled. Also, October 26th and November 9th, we're going to announce this a lot so nobody shows up over here. We won't be doing service here. That's October 26th. And November 9th, it will be at the pastor's house, over there. Let's see. Please be in prayer for the pastor and family with a medical situation with Linda's mother and for the impending travel home. Anything I might have missed? To us again tonight, but right now, Lou and Paul. And Jess.
Good evening. Can we go to prayer? Present Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this night. This is all about you, Father. We want to bless you tonight. And God, we just send your Spirit, your Holy Spirit, to fill this room today, tonight. And we send up special prayers for our pastor, who is in San Angelo, I guess, and his wife and the whole family. We just ask that you would touch them tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
We're going to do a little something different here. My friend Jack is going to put a little kind of happy song up there.
Down in my heart, since Jesus came.
Good to be back with you again. I didn't expect to be back as soon as I was. I was here about 6 weeks ago, I think, if I remember that. But nevertheless, I'm glad. Joe called me first part of the week and told me about Linda's mom. It was Monday, I guess, is when he called, because we had a meeting scheduled for Monday evening. I was going to be out here for that. He told me what was going on, and I said, well, you need to go. You need to take Linda to San Angelo to be with her family. You know how Joe is. Bless his heart. Well, I said, Joe, you need to go. I said, and I'll cover for you Saturday night if you need that to happen. So, here I am. Ready to do it. Ready to be here. And I didn't want him worrying about anything. We're big people and we can take care of stuff. I was asked before we started the service tonight, do you have any surprises for us? I think I do tonight. I'm doing a series of messages at Green Valley Baptist Church where I pastor on what it means to be a disciple, being a disciple. We hear a lot about that, but what does that mean to us today in our everyday lives? And so I've been talking about some of the characteristics of a disciple. And one of them is disciples abide. They're with Jesus. They follow him. They trust him. They depend upon him. They are abiding. with him. Another one that we did was we talked about disciples serve. They do what needs to be done to serve the kingdom, helping others, doing whatever needs to be done. They give of themselves. It's not selfishness. It's giving of themselves. Another characteristic of a disciple is disciples love. They are there are people that others know that there's something different about them and their lives because of how they treat other people. They love other people. And I think one of the astounding statements I think we discovered with that is we understand how disciples love and we can love because God first loved us, is God does not love us less than he does other people. And God does not love us more than he does other people. God loves. And tomorrow's message is going to be another characteristic of disciples is disciples pray. So tonight, you get that message, because this one's fresh on my heart and my life all this week, and you'll get it before Green Valley Baptist Church comes. You're not getting a retread, you're getting a brand new message, and Green Valley gets a retread more morning. But I think it's important for us to really understand what it means for us as Christ's disciples to have an effective prayer life. So we're going to turn over into Matthew, the Gospel of Matthew. Guess where? Chapter 6. It's part of the Beatitudes. And this is where Jesus is going to be giving some instructions on prayer. And one other thing that we've learned through this series is that Jesus has said, not everyone who claims to be following him actually is following him. Matter of fact, he points something out. He says, you'll know who my people are by their fruit, by the fruit that they bear, the way they conduct themselves. You see, spiritual fruit is, in essence, an authentication of true Christ-following faith. And so we're looking at tonight at the attribute of a disciple of Christ is disciples pray. Now we might look at this and say, well, everybody prays. You know, we have sort of a conundrum in our country today when there's so many rules, laws put into place hindering like prayer in schools, and I'm not going to try to chase that rabbit. But you let some catastrophe happen, what do all of the buckety bucks say? Well, I pray. So let's really just come to grips with it. Not everyone who says pray really understand what prayer really means. But here's the catch, you see. True disciples of Jesus don't pray any way they choose to pray. They choose to pray the way God has taught us and showed us how to pray. They've learned to pray God's way, taught by God's Son, that's revealed to us in God's Word. It could be the whole sermon in just a sentence right there. Disciples learn to pray God's way, taught by God's Son, revealed to us in God's Word. So in our text today, Jesus says, there is praying done by people that is neither heard or even heeded by God. He's pointing that out to us. Really, we need to really come to understand is the point of our prayer life is for us to have the ear of God. for him to hear us. And if we're praying and God isn't listening, it's a complete waste of time. You see, it's possible to pray all day, but pray also all wrong at the same time. There was a Gallup poll done several years ago, and they did this survey and found that more than 90% of Americans say that they pray routinely, but less than 15% of those people, listen to this, felt like God was listening or even cared. So maybe the problem is, it isn't the amount of prayer, but our approach to prayer. And so God gladly answers those prayers from his disciples when they approach him in the right way. We need to think about this. Prayer is a gift that comes with some guidelines, and we're gonna discover that this evening. If we want our prayers to be heard by God, we follow what his guidelines are, and they're found in Matthew chapter 6, and we'll read verses 5 through 13. And when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, that they may be seen by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you pray, go into your room and shut the door, pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases, as the Gentiles do, for they think they will be heard for their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. Pray then like this. Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we have also forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Now, I want you to notice something. Jesus did not say, if you pray. What does he say? He says, when you pray. You see, for a disciple of Christ, for a Christ follower, prayer is an optional. It's essential for us in our walk with Christ. Jesus very clearly wants his disciples to understand not all prayer is created equal. Not all prayer is effective. Not all prayer is embraced. So let's answer this question tonight. How do we pray God's way as disciples of Jesus? Here's the first thing. We need to check our motives when we pray. We need to check our motives when we pray. 5 and 6, when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand, pray in the synagogues, at the street corners, that they may be seen by others. Truly, I say to you, they have received their reward. And when you pray, go into your room, shut the door, pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Now, let me jump in and say this real quick. Jesus is not condemning public prayer. He's not condemning that whatsoever. Matter of fact, let me give you some examples. When Jesus prayed publicly, what about when he fed the 5,000 people? He stood up before all those people and asked God to bless those fish and those loaves of bread. He prayed publicly. There's another instance where he prayed publicly. It was at the time when he stood at Lazarus' grave and he prayed, and Lazarus was raised from the dead. He prayed publicly. When did the Holy Spirit come? What was happening then in Acts 1:8? There was a public prayer meeting going on the day of Pentecost. Public prayer has always been a common practice of God's people. Jesus isn't condemning prayer in the presence of others. Jesus is condemning prayer with the absence of transparency, of just saying empty words. He explains what a hypocrite looks like when they're praying. Oh, they sound very holy and they sound very humble, but they're not. They sound like they love God wholeheartedly, but they don't. They sound like they're giving God all the glory, but actually they won't do that, because you see, when they're praying without transparency and they're just trying to put all these other words and all this stuff together, you know what they're wanting to do? They're wanting to share the limelight with God. They're wanting for people to say, oh, I'd love to hear Brother so-and-so pray. That's sharing the limelight with God instead of, oh, I love to hear the words and just see what God's going to do with so-and-so. See, the problem with the hypocrite isn't that he prayed in public. Is that, here's the problem, he only prayed in public. So others could see him, and others could brag on him about what his prayer life was like. The reason he did that was because that's the only way he could get what he really wanted. That was the attention and the adoration of other people. You see, he'd rather be praised by man than heard by God. He'd rather appear to be spiritual than to be spiritual. He'd rather seem to be godly than be godly. And Jesus says some very incredible words there at the end of verse 5. He says, I say to you, they have received their rewards. In other words, his prayer, he got what he wanted, the attention of men. But he did not get what he wanted, what he really needed, was the attention of God. Some would say, well, that's never my problem because I don't pray publicly. People have issues with that. I remember I pastored a church in Louisiana. One of my very good friends, one of my best friends, member of our church, neighbor, lived right down the street from me. When I became the pastor, he told me, he says, John, I don't pray out loud. And you know, I'm a pastor. I try to be sensitive to that, and I don't try to embarrass people. But I also knew this guy needed to kind of step up his game a little bit. I never called on him to pray. Just out in the congregation. One day, he was an usher to take up the offering. Came up to the front, stood there with his head bowed, knowing I was going to call the other guy standing next to him. But I thought, D-Wiff, lead us in prayer this morning. He looked at me, and his eyes got real big. And then he prayed a very simple, sincere prayer. Dear God, thank you for the offering we have. Please bless it. That's a simple prayer. And I told him, he came up to me afterwards, why did you do that? Because I said, you needed to learn how to pray. And you did what needed to be done. Thank you for doing that. Then I'll make a call on in prayer. Had to help him grow just a little bit. Let's think about this for a moment. Jesus says some pray publicly because they want others to hear them pray. You see, they're focused on what others hear and think, not what God hears and thinks. And people who refuse to pray with others, even though commanded by God, because they're more afraid of what others think and hear more than what God thinks and hears, are guilty of the very same thing. Powerful praying doesn't start with the right combination of words. Powerful praying comes with the right motivation of our hearts in our approach to God. And Jesus is telling us to get along with God secretly, so that we will begin to know Him intimately. And when you know the heart of God, here's the key. When you know the heart of God, you're not worried about what others think about you pray out loud. When you know His heart. James 4:3 says, "You ask and do not receive because you ask wrongly and spend it on your passions, such as selfishness, pride, evil, jealousy, materialism, idolatry." Too many times those are the motives that drive many people's prayers. James says, when our motives are ungodly, our prayers go unanswered. Here's something important to remember. Praying to a holy God with unholy motives is like talking on a phone that has no service. There's no connection. You're not going to have any kind of communication. And when you pray, ask yourself this question. Does what I am praying, does it align with what God's word has to say? Does my prayer align with what God's word has to say? Am I focused on God's kingdom, or am I focused on my kingdom? Am I more concerned with what God thinks or what others think? Is this about God's will being done or about my will being done? So pure motives will produce powerful prayers. Secondly, disciples of Jesus will engage their hearts when they pray. Verse 7, "And when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think they will be heard for their many words." Now, pagan worship is true even today. Pagan worship oftentimes consists in repeating chants over and over again to their gods. Their prayers are repetitive. They're ritualistic. They're sort of treating prayer like a vending machine. All right, I'm going to put in my money and hit the button, and God's going to deliver something to me, or their God is. Put in the right kind of words, and the request is going to be granted. I give you what you want, God, you give me what I want. But Jesus is saying this. Prayer isn't the constant repeating spiritual words or memorized prayers. Prayer is to be a genuine expression of love and faith expressed by a person who knows they have been redeemed, they have been forgiven, they have been transformed by a very gracious and loving God. True prayer is guided by the Word of God, empowered by the Spirit of God, and offered from the heart of a child of God. That's what true prayer is. You know, every once in a while, we maybe get a card, maybe a birthday card, or some sort of a thank you, or a card to encourage us, get well card. And when we get these cards from someone, what means the most to us? As we open it up, and you see the beautiful poem that was written by a professional poem writer for Hallmark or for whoever. Or is it what that hand scribbled note at the end of that poem, of that family member or that friend that writes something especially for you. That's what means the most to it. I'm going to be honest with you. If I get a card and I see something handwritten on the bottom of it, I read that first before I read all the other stuff. The other stuff could be nice. I appreciate it. But what I really want to know is what that person that I know personally had to say to me. Because you know what? I know it's from their heart. James 5:16 says, the effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man does what? Avails. Those words, effective and fervent, they're all one word in the Greek, and we get our word energy from that Greek word that describes effective and fervent. And this is what James is saying. Real prayer has energy. It has intensity, spiritual energy, spiritual intensity. Have you ever heard someone just string along about 10 cliches and just say amen at the end of it? No passion, no energy, no heart, no thought. Same old, just going through the motions. Be with me and my family, bless me and my family, help me and my family, forgive me and forgive my family, bless the missionaries, amen. I promise you. The devil isn't afraid of that kind of prayer. Not bothering him one bit. It's okay to ask God to bless, to help, to forgive, but when it just becomes rote, same thing over and over again, that indicates a prayer absent of heart will be absent of power. This is what we need to remember. As disciples of Christ, God does business with those who mean business with Him. God does business with those who mean business with Him. Third thing is, disciples are going to use their ears when they pray. Look at verse 8. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask Him. You see, Jesus' examples of wrong prayer are from people concerned about what they are going to say. The hypocrite is concerned about what he's going to say to impress others. The heathen is focused on what he's going to say over and over and over because he thinks it's the words, the amount of words spoken is what the key to prayer is. But Jesus says what? Don't be like them. Focus more on what you're going to say. Because listen, we need to remember this. You know what? Our Father in heaven is brilliant. He's brilliant because you know He already knows what you need before you ask Him. The most important aspect of prayer is not what you say to God, but listen to this, what God has to say to you. God already knows what you have to say to Him, but you don't know what He wants to say to you. So we need to be listening for that. God hears and understands us. Or are we listening and understanding? What if I get a drink of my Diet Coke so I can finish this? So, I shouldn't be drinking this, but Dr. tells me that. But it tastes so good. Jeremiah 33:3 says, call to me and I will answer you and will tell you great and hidden things.
The exciting part about prayer is not just what we say, but who we say it to. Because he says to me in that passage we read, call to me. When we're praying, we're talking directly to God. Not his assistant, not an angel, not a secretary, not an answering service. We talk to the Creator of this universe. He wants to talk to us as well, too. When God spoke in Genesis 1, this world came into existence. And I can promise you this. Whatever God wants to say to you will change your world as well, too. Because you see, when you pray, use your ears for listening more than your mouth for speaking. Disciples who follow Jesus will listen with their ears. The last thing, disciples of Jesus follow their instructions when they pray. Then we get down to the part that we're very familiar with, what is known as Lord's Prayer. Verse 90 says, pray then like this. All right. This is where you may get mad at me. I don't know about mad. You may get, what? John, what are you talking about? Unfortunately, some have turned these verses into a vain repetition by repeating them over and over and over again. Jesus, hear me on this. Jesus isn't saying, pray this. He is saying, pray then like this. My Bible, starting in Matthew 6, verse 5, it has sort of a subject heading over verse 5. It says the Lord's Prayer. I bet your Bible says the very same thing. This really isn't the Lord's Prayer. This is a disciple's prayer. Did you know that Jesus probably never prayed this prayer? What? What do you mean? How do we know that? He never had to pray for forgiveness because he was sinless.
Amen.
Jesus is giving prayer instructions, guidelines, Matthew chapter 6, 9 through 13. He said, pray like this, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. What's he saying here when he tells us to pray this like this? He's saying, focus on God. Remember how awesome, remember how gracious he has been. Then he said, pray like this, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. You see, prayer is meant to get my will aligned with God's will. Prayer is not getting what we want, it's getting what God wants. And God's will is done, when God's will is done completely, perfectly, and there's joy in heaven. Our desire is to see his will done in our lives the way he wants our lives to be. Then he says, then pray like this, give us this day our daily bread.
involved as well, too. Emotional, relational, spiritual needs, those things that we need in our lives today to be able to be alive. God, with your will. He says, ask for this. Then he goes on to say, and forgive us our debts as we have also forgiven our debtors. This is what Jesus is saying to his disciples. You know what you need to do? You need to come clean before God. Let him point out our sins, our flaws, our failures. Not to make us feel bad, but to help us learn and help us to grow, to be a better disciple, to be a better follower of Christ. And then he also encourages to, tells us to pray for spiritual direction. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Friends, we have an enemy who wants to lead us and tempt us into going in the wrong direction every day. So prayer leads us to victory over sin, over self, and over Satan. And when you pray, we need to ask ourselves, maybe you'll ask yourself tonight as you close this day out, Father, tonight as I come to the end of this day, am I following Jesus' instructions about prayer, or am I reducing my prayer life down to an emergency call or a grocery list? Go through my things, my world. World Magazine did an interview with Joni Erickson Tala. I use that in illustration about Joni Erickson Tala a few weeks ago when I was here. Joni's lived as a quadriplegic for almost 50 years because of a diving accident she had when she was 14 years old. And she said when she realized she was never going to walk again or live without the help and care for other people, she wanted to die. After struggling with anguish, anger, grief, confusion, Joni says she finally prayed one short prayer that changed her life. This was her prayer. Oh God, if I can't die, show me. To be our prayer as we begin each day. Oh God, show me how to live for you this day. And that will be a prayer. Praise, just praise sincerely. That God will hear. God will answer. He will show you the way. Us through our lives each and every day. Will you join me in prayer, please? I would say probably, Father, probably each one of us in this room. Before you each day in our time of prayer. words not be the most important thing, but Father, that we will be listening for your words that will impact our lives. Help us to be the Christ follower Jesus wants us to be. Father, in these moments, may this be a time of rededication, recommitment of our prayer life to you, so that we can be effective, fervent prayer warriors for your kingdom. It's in the name of Jesus, our Savior, I pray. Amen. All right. Anything else we're doing tonight? Is that it? Thank you for being kind.